Philippine Supreme Court spokesperson Brian Keith Osaka is holding a press briefing. Let's listen in.
The cases questioning the constitutionality of the Anti-Terrorism Act, the statement of concern of the Integrated Bar of the Philippines, the University of the Philippines College of Law, and the Free Legal Assistance Group. The judiciary is one of the three pillars of our republican democracy, which itself hangs on a careful balance between and among governmental powers. To threaten our judges and our lawyers is no less than an assault on the judiciary. To assault the judiciary is to shake the very bedrock on which the rule of law stands. This cannot be allowed in a civilized society like ours. This cannot go undenounced on the court's watch. The Supreme Court is mindful that nothing prevents it from standing by all court officers, judges, and lawyers alike, as it now does in no uncertain terms. This principle is not in debate, but has remained fixed on administering justice amid a history of shifting social and political tides. Every threat to a lawyer or a judge that prevents them from exercising their functions has very serious repercussions on the idea that the rule of law must be accessible in an impartial and transparent manner to all parties. Every right guaranteed in the Constitution must be protected. We are all too aware that everything the court stands for must bend its arc toward ensuring that all its officers can fairly and equitably dispense their duties within the legal system, unbridled by the constant fear that such exercise may exact the highest cost. In this light, the court condemns in the strongest sense every instance where a lawyer is threatened or killed, and where a judge is threatened and unfairly labeled. We do not and will not tolerate such acts that only perverse justice, defeat the rule of law, undermine the most basic of constitutional principles, and speculate on the worth of human lives. We acknowledge and share the legitimate concerns of the public, the profession, the judiciary, as well as law enforcers and public servants in general. We are aware that there are wayward elements who, in their zeal to do what they think is necessary, would simply brush aside the limitations in our law as mere obstacles. This should never be countenanced, for it is only in the enjoyment of our inalienable and indivisible rights that our freedoms become meaningful. In this regard, we are taking the following courses of action. First, we have requested our lower courts, as well as the various law enforcement offices, to furnish us with relevant information to shed light on the number and context of each and every threat or killing of a lawyer or judge within the past 10 years. We also urge the public, including public interest organizations, lawyers, and judges groups, to provide us with vetted information on any incident of such threat or killing. We ask that this be done within the remainder of this month and the whole month of April. We are designating the court's public information office to receive and collate these data and provide us with a report prior to our deliberations en banc scheduled for the last week of April 2021. Based on the information provided, the court will then decide on the next courses of action, including the amendment of the relevant rules, or if necessary, the creation of new ones. Second, while this is ongoing, the court en banc has resolved to work on, deliberate, and promulgate rules on the use of body cameras for the service of search and arrest warrants. This is without prejudice to the court's deliberations on whether we can cover with our rules of procedure the conduct of by-bus operations in the enforcement of the Comprehensive Dangerous Drugs Act. Third, we have ordered the Office of the Court Administrator to, one, coordinate with the relevant law enforcement agencies to investigate the most recent incident of a judge being subject of a tarpaulin linking her to organizations considered by law enforcers as communists and rebels. And two, survey among trial court and Sharia judges the extent of threats they have received within the last 10 years. The resulting report would be the basis of further action by the court. We have coordinated with all concerned to provide security and counseling to the judges concerned. The court is ready to provide or coordinate security arrangements for any judge or justice that is similarly threatened. Fourth, we are referring all letters that contain specific incidents to the relevant trial courts, which will then order the parties to convert such letters into the proper remedies, such as, but not limited, to petitions for the writs of amparo or habeas data. Fifth, in all these processes, we will endeavor to coordinate through existing mechanisms with all concerned groups, whether belonging to civil society or law enforcement. We encourage lawyers who have experienced harassment or whose clients have experienced threats or harassment to file the necessary motions in pending cases, petitions, or complaints in order that our courts may receive the evidence, determine the facts, and based on the issues framed, provide the relevant reliefs for each case. General invocations of policy will be better supported by experience with the system. In so doing, we can assess what revision or institutional change is necessary to effectively and efficiently further protect our basic rights. The Supreme Court has always operated within institutional restraints, but it is far from resigned to spectate as clear breaches of constitutional rights are carried out beyond its halls. We remain conscious of our role to ensure that the rule of law is resilient and effective in a just, fair, and timely manner. The bench and the bar, as well as the public, can rest assured that we will continue to unflinchingly comply with our constitutional duty to act decisively when it is clear that injustices are done. The Supreme Court calls upon the entire judiciary and all members of the legal profession to remain strong, steadfast, and unwavering in the duties they swore an oath to fulfill. At no more fitting time than now, should the judiciary remain undaunted with a clear vision of taking courage, enforcing the law, and upholding the supremacy of the Constitution. True to the just virtues we all must fight for, our resolve is unqualified. We recognize the bravery of all the judges and the lawyers who show up to administer justice in the face of fear. Let there be no doubt, the Supreme Court stands with them. Manila, March
23, 2021. And that was spokesperson Brian Keith Osaka with a statement of the Supreme Court saying that the court condemns in all instances and will not tolerate the acts like threatening and killing of lawyers and labeling of judges in unfavorable manners. They are taking the following courses, like requesting the lower courts to furnish with relevant information the number of each and every threat or killing done to lawyers and judges. They are also urging the public to report within the remainder of this month and April and are asking the other departments to collate this information, and then they will decide on the next course of action. The court and bank will also promulgate the rule of body cams for warrants of arrest, and they have ordered the Court of Administration to coordinate to investigate the incident of a judge being considered as a terrorist because of a tarpaulin. Now, to provide security and counseling, that's also what he has promised. And with the current situation and the rise in killings of lawyers under the Duterte administration, the court is ready to provide security for any judge and justice. He ends it with saying that the judiciary remains undaunted in upholding the law in the face of fear. And that's all the news that we have for this hour. Stay here with ANC.